All right, we're going to start a little early, breaking the usual rules of meetings here. As you all know, we are talking about digital India, a topic on which there's lots of passion and interest and energy. We have a panel here which actually has a very interesting mix, so I'll quickly have them introduce themselves, but I'll tell you the surprising thing about it, which is we have someone who's from academia, we have someone who has experience working with farmers using digital technology, someone who has experience thinking about how software companies think about it, and someone who has experience thinking about the public sector. And of course, we have the minister who has the scope of all of it. So we shall, so it would be good, Minister, if we start with you and a quick introduction on about yourself and what you think about Digital India and what the future is.
How much time I have to speak?
You have a few minutes, and then we'll do another round of questions around.
Ladies and gentlemen, at 5:30 sharp, yeah. I will leave. Yeah. I have my cabinet meeting at 5:50. My agenda number is 1. Therefore, you'll have to excuse me. I'll speak for a few minutes. I would have loved to remain here for a long time, but I'm sorry. My name is Ravi Shankar Prasad. I am the Minister for Communication, IT, and also Law and Justice, Government of India. I was also the earlier minister in Mr. Bajpai government, Information Broadcasting, Coal and Mines. Speaking very briefly about Digital India, India is a happening sector as far as IT is concerned. If I will very briefly give some statistics, all of you may be knowing it. The turnover is 108 billion, employment 3 million direct, 100 million indirect. Outsourcing global industry share in India is 50%. We have got 933 million mobile phone connectivity in India. The urban density is 145%, rural is 44%. When Mr. Modi government came to power, we used the power of technology to involve the people of India. We initiated MyGov site, inviting suggestions from people of India on issues like Ganga cleaning, Digital India, child rights, etc. Within a short span of 15 days, we got 2 lakh plus suggestions. A PMO dedicated team works that. We asked them to design for the Prime Minister e-greetings on Independence Day. Within a week, we got 3,000. And the PM ended up sending 4 million e-greetings on Independence Day. This whole inclusion program, Jan Dhan, was suggested by them. And you'll be happy to know, on a single day, August 27 to be exact, we held 78,000 functions in India. We ended up opening 10.3 million bank accounts on a single day. And now it has gone to nearly almost 50 million. And this whole idea, the Prime Minister on 5th of August, September, the birthday of the former president, talked to 200,000 schools in India through the power of technology, involving 20 million school students. So India was the happening place, and Digital India was the first program conceived as a priority agenda within 100 days of inclusion, connecting India through the power of technology. The Prime Minister has said 3S, speed, scale, and skill. 3D, democracy, demography, and demand, 1.25 billion people. Another motto is IT plus IT is equal to IT. Namely, India today plus, or India's talent today plus information technology is India tomorrow. India was sitting at the cusp of a digital revolution. And then came the Digital India program. It is not for the elite, it is for the poor people, the marginalized. Basically, it has 3 components: digital infrastructure for all the citizens for utility. That's point number 1. Point number 2, digital services on demand. Point number 3, digital empowerment of Indians. And what we have done is, what we propose to do is, we want to link all the rural India through optical fiber network. 50,000 cluster of villages, Gram Panchayat we call, this year till the financial year, 100,000 next year, 100,000 next year. This will lead to 3 main upshots: e-governance, e-health, e-education, and above all, e-commerce. Then we are pushing electronic manufacturing in a very big way. India has a very gap area of electronic manufacturing. $100 billion we use to, you know, we use still import into India. It may become $400 billion by the year 2020. We have given a lot of incentives and initiatives for establishment of electronic clusters. I went to Germany, I went to South Korea. Large number of big companies are willing to come in India. And when we say make in India, we don't only say make for India. We say come make in India for Indians and also export outside and get all the incentives. Two quick points. Digital literacy, we are going to encourage in a very big way. Special programs for peer people, marginalized. Common service centers, which we are opening about 150,000, they are there. We propose to increase it further, where women folk and others will operate it, to computers, to broadband, for all these services. This will also lead to backhand amalgamation of services in states after states for their certificates, for land records, other entitlements should be e-enabled. I can only tell you, ladies and gentlemen, India is a huge country and the task is big. But if I can say, India's innovative capacity is enormous. A poor, elderly, illiterate lady knows the significance of a missed call and how to respond to an SMS. Spectrum issue I know is troubling all of you. We are going to straighten it. A spectrum sharing, a spectrum trading guideline are going to be in place by the year end. We are going to have a new auction also. We are in discussion with the Ministry of Defense for the release of extra spectrum. But we want to make the whole regime transparent with twin objective in mind, growth and India's consumers' interest. Lastly, two very quick points and then I'll conclude. First is, I have instructed my officers, and they are still having meeting today under the Secretary's chairmanship, that sit with the stakeholders and whatever is required to ease the problems, come with a solution. If the merger acquisition guideline needs to be revisited, revisit that. The first meeting with the stakeholder is happening today itself. The Prime Minister is personally monitoring this whole National Optical Fiber Network program. I see a very huge role of retailers also in this process, where the expansion of broadband as television expanded in India. For information, you may be knowing, we have got 600 channels in the sky of India. 245, 24 by news channels in India. Many talking sense, some talking nonsense too. But that happens. If India is a happening place. And as television reached every part of India, similarly, we want to push broadband. And innovation. There is a very famous word in India, all of you may be knowing, Jugaad technology, you know. When I get a presentation about the working of the department, I'm amazed to see that you can have recharge of your SIM card even at rupees 10. That's the model available in India. The tariff of mobile connectivity. All these are new areas which has given to the world an extraordinary example of India's commercial enterprise because of sheer size of the market available. I want to push it. I know it is a gigantic task. But I can only say, ladies and gentlemen, India after 26th of May is a different India. Mm-hmm. And we wish to complete that. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So since we have you for not too much...
for 10 minutes.
Yeah, no, true. And we have you for a little while. What we're going to do is, we're going to do a very quick introduction of everyone and what their view of digital
sure,
India and come
sure.
back to you before you leave for another
5:30 sharp.
Yeah, perfect. So, I'll start.
Thank you so much. So, very pleased to hear about the vision, sir. My name is Amit Mehra. I run a business called RML, formerly called Reuters Market Light. We provide information services and e-commerce services to farmers across the country. So I want to talk a little bit about the opportunity it presents, some of the solutions that are out there. But before you leave, press upon something that we have learned the hard way over the last 7 years working with farmers across the length and breadth of the country, which is about behavioral change and how important that would be to actually deliver the end goals that you have behind the Digital India transformation program. So most of you may know that, but just to highlight a couple of statistics, you know, India remains the only country which still has about 600 million people engaged directly or indirectly in agriculture. And as per the CII McKinsey study of last year, we still have only about 60% of our productivity potential reached. Yesterday we heard that we produce about 270 million tons of grains from an area that is double the size that China has, or more than China has, and China produces 500 million tons. So clearly the potential of Digital India and this whole program to empower the farming population directly and indirectly to improve their productivity, to improve their yields, and to improve their price realization and income, and therefore achieve the bigger goal of inclusive growth is phenomenal. But what we have seen while, you know, proliferation of such services has happened over the last 5-6 years, I was sitting with a bunch of female farmers in a village close to Hyderabad a few weeks ago, and they've been using these services which provide them information on advisory, market prices, et cetera, et cetera. And I asked them, you know, do you find these services beneficial? They said, yeah, all of us do. How many of you are able to reap the benefit of these services? Only a handful, just about 30% or so. And we have seen this repeatedly in study after study done by the World Bank, done by the USAID, done by the GIZ, et cetera, saying that while 90 to 95% of the people find these things beneficial, the actual benefit that they're able to derive from it is very limited. And a large part of that has to do with it requires changing the behaviors. It is not about education and awareness about these services. It is about embedding them in their daily routines, which takes a long time. So I'll come back to that, but I just wanted to start with leaving that point for you to consider, that it will require consistent effort from the private sector, working with the public sector to actually engineer that behavioral change at scale for it to be really, really meaningful and transformational.
So Bhaskar Pramanik, chairman for Microsoft. And, you know, I and my company, I've been around in the technology industry in India for the last 42 years and just for another 3.5 years with Microsoft. So I've had the opportunity to see how technology has actually evolved in India and shaped. You know, when I graduated from college, the microprocessor hadn't been invented. So it's good to see where we are today. The point I really wanted to make was that, you know, what I see different today is the fact that everything which you're doing from a Digital India perspective is focused on the citizen. It wasn't the same before, because previously it was about a state government wanting to do a particular mission mode project, or it was a central government trying to do a particular department. But this time, it's all about the citizen. And that, I think, is a tremendous opportunity which we have. The second, I think, is about the fact that, at least with all the interactions we've had, I don't think the government says, look, we have all the answers. We want everybody to participate. We want the students, we want the citizens, we want the private industry, we want industry associations, we want everybody to participate. And I think that that is completely welcome. It's not about looking down. It says, here's the vision, but let's get everybody together. And I think that that is really very, very profound, and I want to compliment the government for doing it. The third is a sense of urgency. And I still remember the first meeting which I had with you, with Chandrajit Banerjee of CII, myself, and another colleague from CII. And you said that, look, I apologize, I have only 10 minutes. I want you guys to tell me, I'll tell you my two biggest problems, and I want you guys to tell me in 30 seconds what you can do, and the solution shouldn't take 10 years to fix. And I still remember we told you two things. One is we talked about last mile connectivity, and we talked about manufacturing in India. And you told us that these are your two biggest problems. What can you do? I remember I talked to you about last mile connectivity, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that just now. But when we talked to you about manufacturing in India, electronic products, the suggestion we gave was the duty structure. And I remember 3 weeks later, the duty structure got changed. So the speed at which you envision, but the speed at which you're also executing, I think I want to commend you also for that.
Thank you.
The empowerment piece for citizens is also something which I think is very, very powerful. The fact that you want to involve the citizen,
not just in terms of giving him a service, but about empowering him to actually take part in governance. And I wanted to also talk about that in terms of technology. So you mentioned three things in terms of technology. In terms of the programs which you have. One is on infrastructure, one is about empowering the citizen, and then the third one was about providing citizen services on demand. On the infrastructure side, I have two suggestions. One is about last mile access, and one of the technologies which Microsoft has actually deployed in other parts of the world, including in our campus at Redmond, is something which we call Wi-Fi technology. It's dynamic spectrum, it uses the TV white spaces in between TV channels, and it can actually reach distances of over 10 kilometers, which means that where your national optical fiber link ends, you could actually set up routers which have a distance which can cover up to 10 kilometers. And you can use standard off-the-shelf devices to connect to that. So you could have a self-help group, women's group, you could have a Kirana store, you could have a cafe, coffee day, you could have a bank or a post office actually setting up a router and providing free access. So there are solutions like this which I think would make it a lot better. This is emerging technology, so we could build an ecosystem around that. We could manufacture products built on this. We could therefore create the Internet of Things in rural areas based on this. So the advantage which we get as a country is that we could become the leaders on a technology which is just about evolving. And it does require some policy and regulatory requirements, but those are things which are easily handled. The second, I think, is, again, part of your program where you talked about digital identity. And we felt that, again, there is something where India's one of our biggest assets is really the Aadhaar. The opportunity to take Aadhaar, which is a physical identity, and convert it into a digital identity is huge, where it can be used not just for accessing services, but to really show the person who he is. The problem with the internet is that everybody, you can be anonymous. It's like the US Marines, be what you want to be. And sometimes it's not what everybody else expects. But if you have a digital identity linked to your Aadhaar, then you could actually give people the digital locker. They could keep all their certificates from birth to death, and then they could actually then share it depending upon the application, the service, or whoever else they wanted it. The second
can I interrupt you a little bit, just given the time?
Sure.
I'm going to have them talk as well and give the minister a chance to...
I'll come back on the other two areas for some other suggestions.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I will be exceptionally brief. My name's Adaire Fox-Martin, and I have the pleasure of running SAP for Asia-Pacific Japan, and have been a frequent visitor and active in India for 15, 16 years now, so I have seen a lot of change over the time. When I think of the concept of digital India, what I think of, or what comes forward most to mind, is a quotation from Leonardo da Vinci, where he said, "Simplicity is the ultimate form of sophistication." And when we're really talking about including and empowering people, it's making the services, the applications, the access so easy and so simple to consume that it almost addresses the problem that my colleague raised over here. So when you talked about your three S's, I'd love to add the word simplify and create a fourth S there, because really for me, simplification and the battle against complexity is probably one of the most pervasive battles of our time.
I'm Deb Roy. I'm chief media scientist at Twitter and on the faculty at MIT, at the MIT Media Lab. Recently, Twitter and MIT came together and formed a new laboratory for social machines, which I direct. Taking the perspective that we see through Twitter as an example of the power of digital networks in decentralized groups of people who can now express their opinions, and lead to real social change, to lead to behavior change, as Amit referred to, which is a hard thing to do. What we see is decentralized networks leveraging the internet tend today to lead to more ad hoc and disruptive kinds of social change. When you have protests, for example, which can happen in a moment, that is the current trend. And we see a real potential to leverage this new social energy that's being released through decentralized networks and learn how to create design systems that channel that energy for, rather than ad hoc and disruptive energy, instead move towards systematic, constructive social change. And just to give you one example of how we see some of these ideas coming together in a context of digital India in a rural setting, the idea that you have networks of children who have access to smartphones and the services, the content for learning, but combine that with the social network that surrounds that child, the teacher, the parents, the coaches, all of whom have digital touch points. The opportunity to create deep transformation is that we can not only deliver the services, but also map the communication and social interaction between all of those, that ecosystem around the child, and map, first of all, the kind of structure and dynamics that are actually at play in a way that we just can't see. There's sort of a new microscope being built as we speak to see those dynamics. And then with appropriate theories of change, actually go and design shifts in these coupled systems and diagnose where the theory of change is failing and go and intervene with a kind of efficiency and scale that is just never been possible before. So there's huge opportunities, and I think that really India can be the place that shows the way for how to make that happen at a scale that will have global implications. So I'm very excited about that idea.
So we have been running our own Twitter experiment before this meeting, and so I'm going to put one question, which I think is in a way a summary of many of the things were said that I think many people here in the room were interested in. You have come to power with a very different view of the role of the government, and one of the things that is especially true for the sector we are talking about, there's a lot of there's a huge role of the government. There's regulation, there are other issues. So from your point of view, do you think of that, if you had to divide the world up in three buckets, as in what are the things that you visualize only the government doing, what are the things that would be in the bucket of PPP kind of models, and what is really open field for private? And this has been one of those squishy areas, and this applies to everything, right? Which services do you see largely being provided by the government, and so on?
Very quickly, I think I have 7-8 minutes.
Yeah.
First of all, thanks for the kind words. Digital India is not only a government program, government of India's program. We have to work with the state governments. We have to work with private players. And we are open to suggestions 24/7 for improving it. The first thing I would like to tell you. And this government is working with an open, very mindset. And the Prime Minister's key word always is, outcome is more important. This is how we are going. We changed the duty structure within a fortnight,
exactly.
Once I heard about it, and the budget, you saw that. In the last about 35 years, for the first time, electronic goods got so much of support. I think in the whole discussion, what we are missing is the innovative idea of Indians. And let me give you two instances. The smartphone is rising in India by 45%, the highest growth outside USA, for your information. Just two quick, very earthy examples. One of my professional juniors always gets her supply of food grains from her village home in Madhya Pradesh. She likes the pulse and the wheat there. One day, her grocery shop owner in a remote Mufassil town got it loaded on the goods train, used the WhatsApp, sent the receipt photocopy on her mobile phone, the exact wagon number, the station at which it would reach in Delhi on what date at what time, his old bank account number for electronic transfer. And she was amazed. He has never been taught about anything electronic. But he picked up the need to employ that technology for his business. The second is more fascinating. Rajat Sharma, the famous TV personality, had gone to have the Aaj Tak program, famous program, people come and ask questions. We're having lunch. He said, interesting thing for you to know, that whenever he used to return from his studio, his servant was found to be sitting on a particular motorcycle before a particular house playing with his smartphone. On the third day, he asked his wife, why the hell he always sits there? He said, very simply, the Wi-Fi connection in front of the house is the best. And he uses that to save Brazil football. That is India. Therefore, Indians are prone to use technology. You only create the enabling atmosphere. You don't have to have much of education for that. That is a big assurance for India. On the farm sector, you have a point. Yes. We need to work more. We can learn from your experience. As far as your query is concerned, I see very powerful role for private players in the distribution network. For instance, once the broadband area is in place, the huge market of India, and the rural market is rising very fast. E-education, e-health, e-commerce, e-retail, all are going to come in a very big way. Distribution of broadband in the urban area and the rural area. I have asked my officers to work out a very proactive platform as to how to virtual internet can become a reality as far as distribution is concerned. There are big ISPs are there. There are big service providers are there. How can we have a virtual operator who can become take small broadband and distribute it in a cluster of areas? Yeah. And I have asked the TRAI to finalize the whole guidelines in that. The larger issue I would like to highlight, it is a very proactive government. And yes, the brief of the Prime Minister to me is what? I want government available on my mobile phone. I think that is a mission statement. And we have got a mobile Seva facility where I'm told nearly 360 facilities are available. Election Commission, where you are registered as a voter, you can click, you can get that pull information and push information. From railway ticketing to air ticketing to so long, all are available. This whole disaster management information is being done through mobile phones in a very big way. Now, once broadband becomes a reality, a whole range of canvas opens up for business, for retail, for involvement of private sector, and newer forms of PPP model. Your point on simplification and sophistication is well taken. But my take of India is a little different. And this take I always acquired after watching India as a political activist from my student days. And India is a place where rocket science will work and yoga technology will work side by side. Okay? Where 4G will work and the simplest mobile, where I can only give a missed call and SMS, will also work. India cannot be segregated. But allow Indians to play with their technology, give an enabling atmosphere, and they will go for a smartphone in a very big way. I think this mindset of Indians must be kept in view when you design the policy. Yes, a regulatory measure should be as free as possible, and today I want to inform you that I have already constituted a committee, which I said in my initial comment, headed by the Secretary of Telecom. Talk to the stakeholders. Ease of doing business must be also replicated in my department. And whether you need to revisit the guideline, do visit. And I think this is a statement I'm making when I'm the Minister for Telecom. I'm not only the Minister for BSNL and MTNL. I'm the Minister of the sector. Okay. The sector needs to grow. Yeah. The same I have for IT also. The sector needs to grow. And when I go abroad and see great interest of big manufacturers to come in India, I think this is a very big, big opportunity. As for the Twitter part is concerned, some of the sensitive information, that is a question. India firmly believes in freedom of expression, freedom of press. But it's a big India, it's a diverse India. And we have got fundamental right of speech, but that is subject to reasonable restrictions. So while permitting complete flow of information, stakeholders like you have to take those concerns on board, that while exercising that right, we don't allow terrorists to spread their own message, allow riotous-like situation to happen in India. How can that be done? I don't see much of role of the government, because I'm a great supporter of the freedom of the press and the freedom of expression. But you as the big operator have to take that factor into account as to how it can be handled. Well, ladies and gentlemen, my concluding remark is only this. I am greatly honored to come in this very extraordinary economic summit by the World Economic Forum in conjunction with CII. Feel free to give me suggestions. We have to make Digital India a great success. I'm appealing to all of you. I am just a phone call away. if you feel that some concrete suggestions will improve Digital India implementation. I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
I think I have your permission to leave. You can carry on. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. In parliamentary democracy, a cabinet meeting is more important than India Economic Summit.
Thank you, sir.
Sorry.
So I think as a follow-up, we will do what we had originally planned, which is to have you talk about your experience as Digital India and farming, which seems like an intersection not made in heaven.
Sure.
So, you know, can you elaborate, and specifically around some of the examples you mentioned earlier on, where you see it working, and the idea was how can some of these things scale up, right? While there are lots of interesting ideas, can they really have impact?
Sure. So first of all, very, very pleased to hear the Honorable Minister say that he's open to suggestions. We were looking forward to and I'll make sure that I get hold of the mobile number at some point. One of the challenges we have seen is the biggest challenge, in fact, has been how to institute behavioral change at scale. And let me give you some of the examples of what I mean by that. So another example, I was sitting in outside our stall in Nagpur. There was a big farmer mela, a farmer fair. And I was just deliberately standing outside, and there were farmers walking into our stall and looking at, you know, what kind of services we provide and information around market prices, weather, intelligence, advisory, everything that they need to know to improve their productivity, price realization, etc. So a farmer from a particular state walks in, and when he's coming out of the stall, I ask him, so do you know about this company? He says, yeah. Do you know what services we provide, or they provide, pretending not to be from the company? He says, yeah, it's very good. This is, you know, everything that I need to know. It helps me improve my productivity, et cetera. So I was sold from the info that he shared on my behalf about our company, and I said, do you use the service? He said, no, I don't. And I said, why don't you use it? Because you said that it is, you know, extremely beneficial. He says, no, you know, I was using it in the past and I got some benefit. I made about 20,000 rupees more by, you know, realizing higher price. But then it wasn't really available close by. You know, there wasn't easy access to this. And this is just one of the many, many examples that we encounter where, particularly for an application or a service that will run on the Digital India platform, which we call in RML parlance the vitamin applications. I'll explain how they differ from the antibiotic or killer applications. But what we have seen is that for an average farmer who's 51 years old, even in the very difficult subnormal monsoon season, when we are telling them to use mulching in a certain way, when we are asking them to do pitcher harvesting, when we are asking them to, you know, put certain drops of sodium carbonate to save water when it is likely to rain, all of that is, like, you know, directly going to impact his productivity. He will use water, you know, much, much better in a very, very difficult situation that the country encountered this year. It requires that gentlemen, and mostly gentlemen, really, to change what they have been doing for decades and over generations. And it is very difficult to do it in a very short period of time. So there are two things that really impact that. One is, and if I may add to the list of S's, the fifth S that I would put is solutions. So you just can't put an IT app, or you can't just put the infrastructure. You need hyperlocal content. You need the service to support that. You need the right level of awareness. You need the right level of education. And then you need hand-holding over a period of time for the impact, for the solution to be really benefiting that individual. And the solutions which are vitamin in nature, by that I mean the impact of that and the benefit of that comes over a period of time. So it's not an antibiotic. It's not a Facebook or a WhatsApp that if I don't see it tonight or if I don't see the first thing in the morning, you know, my life get disrupted completely. It is something that I need to use consistently over a period of time, maybe over a couple of crop cycles, maybe over a few years before I realize that this is really, really beneficial. So this is the vitamin app. And a lot of what Digital India is trying to do with e-health, e-governance, e-education is of that nature. So it will require, first of all, you know, complete solutions. and a lot of time for people to embed these solutions in their behavior, in their daily routines, and which is a very different, you know, kettle of fish than just, you know, awareness and providing things and leaving it in the hands of the individuals. So that's one aspect of solutions, and the other is around scale. How do you get there? But I'll come to that later. Let me just leave it at that, and then hear other news.
I was going to probe you a little bit on the second part of what you were saying, the innovation around last mile access, if you want to elaborate a little bit on.
So I talked about it. It's basically using this unused spectrum, which is in between TV channels. It's in the 200 to 600 megahertz range. Therefore, it gives you long distance capabilities. Our studies have shown 90% of that spectrum is unutilized in most big cities, and even more so in the rural areas, and therefore that's an opportunity. So I think last mile access is going to become critical. I also want to talk about innovation because the minister talked about innovation. And I think, you know, sometimes we don't really need the latest technology to solve some, you know, life-threatening problems. And I'll give an example of tuberculosis. You know, TB, for example, you have to ensure that you continue to take your dosage. And if you don't, then it actually reduces the potency. Now, in India, Microsoft Research actually came out with a very innovative packaging, which when the person took his medicine, it actually exposed a number. You then dialed a 1-800 number, and with that number which you entered, it did what was called a missed call. The IVR system would record that dosage and that person had taken his medicine. If he didn't take his medicine and he didn't dial the number, then they would activate a healthcare person to go across and give him and tell them to basically take the medicine. So there are examples of this where even low-end technology can actually solve some of these different kinds of problems. You know, we talked a lot about MOOCs, and we've done, last 2 years, we've been investing in working with three colleges, three universities. We have about 40,000 students enrolled. We call it MEC, Massively Empowered Classroom. And what we've learned is that with MOOCs, there's a less than 10% probability that the student will actually complete his program. And the reason was that only the guys who are really interested in gaining higher knowledge completed the programs. Most students felt that unless it impacted their current grades, if it didn't impact them in terms of the work which they were currently doing in university, then they wouldn't do it. So involving the local professors, creating the interactivity between the professor and the student, enabling students to talk amongst themselves, became very, very critical. And it was a blended program, not just some online course from somewhere, but the professors had an opportunity to actually build on it. We call it Massively Empowered Classroom. It's about taking technology but adapting it for emerging markets. And it's something which we are now planning to scale across the rest of the world. So just two examples of innovation.
Arian, what would be your examples that we talked about, especially given that India has a very large public sector, often seen as an area of huge improvement?
Yes.
So what has been your experience around?
Well, first of all, I think I'd just like to comment. I think what both of my colleagues have commented on here is the importance of education and the role that education has in ensuring the success of Digital India. And I think, you know, when you look at some of the processes that we've been alluding to here, it's about how we flatten some of those out and that it right goes not just to the information that a farmer gets, but also to how he gets paid potentially. And, you know, the empowerment of that using technology to a device that's in his hand, that perhaps would also be a change enabler when we look at this, that and educating. And when I look at, you know, this in a flattening out of processes, I think from a public sector perspective in India, that is an enormous opportunity. We've been working with many public sector entities, and what I see in the public sector are very many processes that are 150 years old, at least. If you look at how, for instance, technology is procured, it uses a tender procurement process that can sometimes take 2 years to actually go from woe to go. In this industry, 2 years is a very long time, and the world has changed. So I believe that there is a huge opportunity to iron complexity out, that in terms of digitizing the public sector, there's no point in digitizing existing processes that don't correlate to the business need of the government today, but that we refresh those processes and then digitize them appropriately so that they enable the government to react in all the transparent and accountable and auditable ways that we require to the business requirements of the community and to the needs of the citizens here in India.
So I guess, one comment just that I think applies to both the things you mentioned, that I'm very much in agreement that, you know, behavior change is hard and is critical, and there's not an app for that. although sometimes an app or a piece of technology opens up a new set of possibilities, but it's people who change behavior and can change one another's. And your example of, you know, MOOCs not being, you can't just drop the MOOC in and walk away. You have to understand holistically the social context within which it may or may not work. So given all of that, one of the ways that I think about the technology layer that layers on top of the behavior change that is or is not happening is a kind of amplifier and optimizer of those human processes. And sometimes that optimization, amplification step can have astonishing scale, astonishing effect that almost takes you through a phase shift in human behavior as a result. And so just to take that MOOC example, which I'd love to learn more about offline, as more and more of the what are probably right now face-to-face physical interactions between people, which we will always want and need, leave a digital trace. A lot of the advances in network science and kind of graph analysis and so forth, all the stuff that's coming out of sort of big data analytics, so-called area, can allow us to, again, sort of map what's happening, why did this child learn in this context with that MOOC and this other child who seems quite similar, not, oh, look at this. The coaching dynamic that this child experienced here looks completely different. Maybe it's that. So this idea of having this kind of data, and then you know what in the world of web-based services, A/B testing at a scale, which is again, if you go and look at how Google is tuning its offerings, it's this massively parallel experiment that is letting people's idiosyncratic individual preferences and interests tune and train the machine. And imagine all of that layered on digital India. So a lot of the practice, again, we don't have to invent, they're being invented. Behavior change in marketing, effective marketing is behavior change. If you look at the technologies of behavior change, of identifying in a network who are the influencers, what is the message that's most likely to reach that influencer. Now, if we're talking about a network of children and informal coaches and teachers in a village, and you take that kind of thinking and say, who are the influencers, what's working, what's not, let's do the randomized controlled trials, you know, a fancier way to talk about A/B testing, the kind of platform capability that we could create so that all of the different innovators inside India and out can plug into a platform like that and create a system that continuously learns. And it's not machine learning, and it's not just human learning, it's human machine learning. I think we're seeing it in bits and pieces, but there's...
I can identify with that, because that's the area where, you know, Microsoft has been investing a lot. And, I don't think the minister had a chance to talk about it, but there is the government is thinking about setting up a national cloud, and a national cloud is just not a bunch of servers which is actually serving out applications and services, but there is that layer of data analytics, intelligence, which is going to be built in.
In terms of examples, can I just throw one more example on the table that's kind of concrete? It's become my favorite ever since I visited this little town. So there's a tiny town in the south of Spain called Jun, J-U-N. It's in the province of Granada, population 3,500. And when you look at just through the data feeds, we have access to all tweets, and so we look and we see there's this little hot spot, continuously incredible amount of public conversation coming out of this little spot in Spain. If you go and visit the town, the first thing you'll notice if you run into, for example, a member of the tiny police department in Hoon is they all have Twitter handles embroidered on their uniforms. And the police cruisers have Twitter handles. The police dog has a handle. So what this is actually doing is every time you see that police officer, it's an invitation to speak to that officer in a way that's publicly visible. So there's this, this is a Twitter-specific example. The generalization is using this transformed public sphere where anyone can enter and be heard, and everyone knows. So there's a kind of epistemological hall of mirrors. Everyone knows everyone is there and could potentially see. What that does, it's not just the police, it's every member of the town. If you work for the town, you're on Twitter. So we've been finding, as we're starting to look at the data, these little examples of responsive loops that often have actually three or four players that form a kind of social circuit. So somebody is walking down the street, sees a street light is out, tweets that the street light's out. This is a typical example we just saw a couple of weeks ago. A few minutes later, the mayor, Jose Antonio, tweets back and says, thanks for letting us know. The electrician's on it. He's going to fix it tomorrow. He tweets. Public promise just got made. Next morning, there's a tweet from the electrician with a photograph, ladder still up, light fixed, saying, thanks for letting me know, lamp fixed. And then there's two retweets and a favorite. A little bit of love and recognition. So if you look at just what happened in that dynamic, the fact that there is this public sphere where everyone can talk and everyone can see that everyone's talking, there's a combination of carrots and sticks. The stick is, if I'm the electrician, it is now, like, there's been a promise been made on behalf of me by someone who has some authority, and everyone can see that. So there's a stick. I better go and fix it. And the carrot is what used to be a thankless job. I was just invisible. Suddenly, I'm getting favorites and retweets for doing my job. So there's this combination of sticks and carrots that is compelling a kind of dynamic. Now, that worked because there's a magical mayor. It's a little magical town. It's only 3,500. But I see in that a little bit of, maybe the future of how do you take those principles, how do you leverage the incredible power of digital networks, and then have people understand if you take certain roles and take some meaningful personal action, there's actually an expected system that could go into play. And how do you bootstrap systems like that? When all the elements are there in raw form, but at a different scale, in a different culture, a different context, to actually enable this kind of behavior change that everyone in that town wants to see, so they become responsive to their own needs. That's my example.
Okay. Can I just quickly react to that?
Yeah, just let me make a quick process point so that I get everyone's feedback. So far, we have kept it within the... so we have around, I think, 25, 30 minutes. So what we will do is we'll do one more set of discussion, but we'll also open it up for questions at this point. So if anyone has questions, please feel free to ask. And I might be rude in cutting you if you don't have a question but a statement for the whole. So sorry about that already. Okay, so let him, and I'll get back to you.
So, the example that you gave, similarly profound examples of behavioral change when I've seen the villages with the farmers. It's been now 7 years for us doing this in 70,000 villages with, several million farmers. But even now, to date, every time I go, it gives me goosebumps. They have been able to use the information to negotiate with the middlemen. They have been able to increase their productivity by just putting two drops of the chemical in 1 liter of water. And by using it 10 days later and not 20 days later, they've been able to, save their crop, etc. So that's when it works, it is just beautiful. And the impact it creates on the lives of people, both emotionally and financially, is just remarkable. And that's sort of what we're trying to achieve, as I understand, with the Digital India program. But to scale that kind of behavioral change, while the technology layer and the analytics will be tremendously powerful, and we are applying many of those now, in the recent past started to do that, and marketing literature does tell you quite elaborately how you can, create that behavioral change. So I was listening to Sanjeev from Unilever and Kajol and the others who were talking about behavioral change in the context of sanitation and how challenging it is, even if you put a toilet there, people just don't want to use it for beliefs and behaviors they've been following for, you know, decades, and, you know, it's a more pleasant experience to defecate outside, et cetera, which is a real challenge. You know, that's why these things are not working despite massive outlays. So, you know, I heard examples of how, and really theories about how we can actually do that by investing in education, awareness, sort of campaigns, ads, et cetera, et cetera. You know, below-the-line programs, above-the-line programs, and I was doing the math in my mind, and I was saying, well, this just ain't going to work in our business. So to scale it, it may be easier for a Unilever or a P&G to do that, but to scale something which is impacting such a vast population of the country, for the private players, while they have a big role to play, I think, and to make it sustainable, it does require private investment, it does require private ventures, it has to be done. Across the world, people have realized most of the social problems will have to be dealt with some way or the other by private sector. But the government has a very big role to help bridge that gap. And if that is understood well, while one part of the problem is to give the solutions to affect behavioral change over a period of time and then work with the private sector, take away some of this heavy lifting that is needed to do it at scale so that people start to change their behaviors, and create a framework where multitude of private players competing with each other or one another, and the creative destruction that will happen because of that, let that happen and not come in the way, which we have unfortunately seen in the past, you know, coming in the way. So I think government solutions have to be provided by the private sector. The government can incubate those, and if they're already existing, I think they should, you know, perhaps nurture those. But to achieve scale, government needs to create that framework for these solutions to scale, and they have a pretty big role to play in the next few years.
Can I just give a small quote, because it's just a one-liner? You know, my experience on IT has been very simple, and, you know, there is this quote which I came across. I can't remember who was the author, but it goes like this. It says that a lot of the challenges and problems we see in the world today is because of Stonehenge emotions, medieval institutions, and godlike technology. So basically, it's in our IT language, it's people, processes, and technology. Technology by itself can't solve the problem. And I think that's really what is happening, not just in India, but everywhere else, perhaps a little bit more accentuated as we start getting the next 500 million onto the internet. But we've got to worry about our Stonehenge emotions. We've got to worry about our institutions. That's why we've got to change or make a lot of regulatory. And it's not just technology.
So, there was a question.
My name is Ajay. I report macroeconomy for the public broadcast Doordarshan News. I was wondering if we could imagine that while we are talking about food security in India, can we also imagine about, you know, right to broadband along with the right to food? Mm-hmm. And if we can imagine, how is it possible? Just want to you have an idea from the panelists and anybody from the house. Thanks.
I think yesterday we had the privilege, there was a private session yesterday evening that Samir also hosted, and we had the privilege of discussing elements of this topic, and there was certainly this view that broadband and internet should be considered in the same way as any other utility, you know, water, electricity, and so on. And it came back actually to the, you know, some of the discussions that we had in the group were really around the role of government for a period of time, because there is a view that if we look at the market in India, it is enormous, and commercially it's an enormous commercial opportunity, but it's also very fragmented, and if you look at it on a per panchayat basis, it doesn't justify the cost of infrastructure to move into a single panchayat and create this excess. But if you segmented the country, if you looked at policy that allowed you to make it commercially viable, and that is a policy change that is required, so that government can, for a period of time, create the framework so that the actual private sector can exercise on that framework, invest appropriately, and then deliver the goods and services that are necessary. So I do think it's a timing thing. But I also think that, you know, to the point of both my colleagues here, that government has a very big role to play in helping India to build that platform, facilitating that process, managing this gap between the demand and time as we find it today, so that ultimately the services can be delivered in this way.
Can I just add an additional point to this question?
Yeah.
To this question. So in the U.S. and in Singapore, they've actually passed a law, act, policy, which basically frees up some of the spectrum which was originally meant for TV channels, the 200 to 700, 800. And they've defined a narrow spectrum which is available for all citizens. So it's free spectrum, which enables you to do things like Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi currently is at 2.4 gigahertz, which is on the other side, but that's why it's only 100 meters. But they've actually passed a law to free that spectrum so that anybody can use it. Okay, so I think that's the kind of policy change which would be required for the kind of technology I was just talking about.
We had a question.
Assuming that whatever we talked about today does become a reality in the next 10 years, what kind of income and output multiplier do you see, and what kind of job multiplier do you see?
I can hazard a guess, basis some data actually. So we have seen if it works, and independent studies have done this analysis and validated this as well. So a World Bank study was done which said that if the younger farmers, so the right segment which is more amenable to changing their behavior sooner than the average farmer, if the younger farmer were given access to this product, which is the right information at the right time, personalized to that individual crops and region, et cetera, and his preferences, then they can make a 9% increase in price realization in just one crop cycle. There was another study done by ICRIER which said it could, the income increase could be between 5 to 25%. So even if I were to take a low, the lower end of that, some of these figures, and there are many such studies out there. That's on the agriculture side, which is still about 700 million people or so, or at least 100 million plus cultivating households. It's a tremendous impact in income realization of about 10%. Just by enabling them with the access to a solution and to do it at scale, I would say you take even half of that, and the 5% to an economy of our of the size of India, you can do the math, how big that impact could be. And it doesn't really, the interesting part is it doesn't really cost that much. All it requires is having the right framework within which private players can work with the government. So that's one statistic at least I can throw.
Okay. Yeah, so I do have a statistics on SMB and the, and that's a comparison for the BCG study, which was, Microsoft participated in that. I don't remember the exact data, but it is by geography, by nation, by country. We have the numbers for India and for most of the other countries. But what it basically showed was that SMEs which used IT, their growth was substantially larger than companies which didn't use IT, factor of three, and they also provided employment which was 15 or 30% greater than SMEs which didn't use IT. I can, if you give me your name, I can actually, send that across to you. But there are a lot of statistics which shows that it actually enhances employability and employment. It all needs to be put together.
I think, in fact, we have someone who had quoted those numbers. I'll give you the rough numbers. I think you missed the question. The question was for, sorry to put you on, the question really was what's the multiplier of broadband access or access on the economy overall? And what I remember of the number was that it's for every 10% increase in connectivity, it was something like 3.5% increase for the developing world versus 1.9 or 2% for the developed world. And the surprising thing, whatever the percentage in the numbers was, that it actually has a much greater multiplier in places like India and China than it has elsewhere for many reasons. And I think you had quoted those numbers.
Sorry, I wasn't ready for that. I'm Virat Bhatia from AT&T. That was a report actually done by McKinsey and Google 2 years ago, and they kind of had those numbers out. The upside for developing countries with broadband penetration is far higher, not just use of IT, just penetration of broadband by itself. In India, sort of ranks at about 12%, give or take, in terms of actual broadband penetration. So,
any other questions? All right.
So I'm a farmer, and I can only tell you that
if the technology, the speed of internet is not fast enough in the villages, we'll be using the technology like most people use computers. You just use the Word or the Excel and you don't use the other applications. And there's a feeling, I'm not sure, and I think the panel can tell us, is the cost of net data access increasing? Because if the cost is everything else is supposed to come down with competition, but I think the cost is increasing. So that needs to be clarified.
Yeah, exactly. The data shows that India has some of the highest access costs for broadband.
It's increasing also.
Yeah, it's increasing and high already. Anyone wants to take that question?
I think yesterday's session, you probably could, because we had a very good session on that yesterday.
Yeah, so we are going to include...
I'm sorry, I just came to
so, there's an empty seat here.
Far from me to be in the ministry. I think the cost of access per megabit, just as the distinguished gentleman put it, is amongst the highest in the world, in India, in the sort of top 10. And that is a factor of a couple of things, including the purchasing power parity vis-a-vis what Indians can pay. Our per capita income, as you know, is about 40% of China or slightly less than that. So it's fairly high in just in sort of absolute in relative terms. But also, I think the reasons are very expensive spectrum, fragmented spectrum, and duties. Just so you know, out of every 100 rupees that an operator gets, approximately 35 rupees is just paid as levies to the government. And for every 100 rupees that they spend on costs, the single largest cost is a spectrum. In fact, starting this year, the outflow for spectrum payments to the governments will exceed the investment that they're making in infrastructure in India. So that then causes the kind of challenges that the gentleman just talked about. Yeah. And it'll get worse because as you go to video, then the capacity that is required to put that through is much higher and will become far more expensive.
But that's using the current 2G, 3G, 4G technology. Yeah. So, you know, I think, you know, we need to understand that there are also a lot of other ways of doing broadband other than through cellular.
And I guess just, you know, to Ajit, to your point, it is a challenge. Recently we saw some of the farmers downloading our application. It's an Android app. For a 3 MB app, it was taking them in some parts as much as 15 minutes and was costing them about 75 rupees to just download, and the service itself was being given free. So what we have done, and I think most of the companies will do that, till the solutions really come on the broadband side. So we cut it down by half, made it 1.5, we're bringing it down to 1, making it bare minimum, you know, in terms of the size of the app so that it can be downloaded quickly. But that is indeed a challenge. So we saw about 50% of the people who were trying to download the application abandoned the session halfway because it was just taking too long, it was costing them too much, and 80% of them are on prepaid. So they knew that their balance is going to go away if they download this app. They might as well use for the antibiotic apps, the Facebook and WhatsApp.
I'm sorry for this, but you know, in the villages, the government says this, you've done rural electrification, no electricity comes in those lines. And we are very worried that you might have broadband, but there'll be no speed coming in those lines. And I think as a farmer, there's a case for Competition Commission of India to act on the telecom and internet companies at the moment. And that really, I mean, that's the feeling.
Yeah.
Good. All right, we have someone else who has a question.
more of a comment from our discussion yesterday, which was talked about, and just for the gentleman there, we talked about cost, which was articulated. We also talked about value. The reason that you are asking that question is the fact that you are seeing value to the fact that you will have that access. And at some point in time, the value is going to outstrip the cost that is associated with providing that access. So, you know, it's a question of timing, like we talked about. So we got to think about that as well, that there is going to be some, we have to figure out how to increase the value to a point that the farmers would be willing to pay the cost, which is incurred. I'm not an operator, so just a disclaimer from that point.
Any other? We have one more question. Please go ahead.
Hi, my name is Leshem Bhai. I work for the Press Trust of India. I'm sorry to be sounding a little bit pessimistic compared to most of the people over here. What I wanted to understand is, you know, when you talk about digital India and connecting all the villages across India, there are so many villages across India where you don't even have the basic electricity. So when we have those kind of situations where, and forget about your broadband connection. So how do you kind of connect with those villages also? And when we talk about connectivity and digital India, are we talking about connectivity through the mobile network, or are we talking to the broadband? Yeah. And is there a possibility of the digital divide increasing all the more because of this?
Before I lob that question to someone here, just a quick summary of some of the conversations that have happened exactly this question. Thanks for asking that, because I was going to otherwise ask the elephant in the room question, which is that while you're talking of access, there is problem of electricity, water, many other fundamental things. I would say two things. One is there were similar questions when mobile telephony was first introduced, that we didn't have many of these things also, and now we have almost 700, 800, however million phones. So how people actually use the phones and what they do with it is something that's very hard for us to foresee. So I wouldn't trade off access and phones and broadband versus having basic infrastructure, at least is one part of the answer. But I would like, anyone else who wants to take that question, you, for example.
Well, I think if we go by, and there the private sector has a pretty big role to play, if we go by the use case, the end user, the solution that is needed for the end user, then I think one can figure out ways around it. So, for example, when we started, smartphones were not even there. I mean, even phones were not there 7 years ago. And we started with a basic feature phone with simple SMSs and a phone call, the things that the farmers were able to do. And they were able to charge and were behaviorally accustomed to doing, reading SMSs and making phone calls. And they were able to charge the phones using the generators. And there were ways and means in which they could find their way around. So I think as long as we keep focusing on the end solution and the behavioral change, whatever is available right now, we'll be able to make use of as private sector. But once that starts to happen and the use cases start to get proven, then is when the government should come in, the big way to help bridge that gap till it becomes sustainable. Yeah.
So the only other point I just want to say is that, first of all, I don't think anybody has a solution which is for 100%. Yeah. And every single citizen of India in every single village in every single nook and cranny. I think if we want to really get prosperous, we've got to keep moving at it. The technology I talked about, Wi-Fi, in Kenya, we're using solar power. So it's possible to do some of these with that kind, but even then, I can guarantee you there may be certain parts of India where you don't even get to see the sun, perhaps, so all the time, or perhaps for long stretches of time, perhaps in the monsoon. So what do? You don't have broadband then. So I think you will have to solve some of those issues as you go along.
I just wanted to comment on, I often hear this, you're thinking about smartphones in a village and there isn't electricity. And I think that looking at holistic sort of system solutions and recognizing that it's really difficult to kind of set priorities and say, oh, electricity over phones. Yesterday I was in a village with, they had a community toilet, and associated with that community toilet was a collection of sun lanterns, and there was a habit formed. The girls in the village would use the bathroom on the way to school. They would deposit their lantern. They'd pick it up at the end of school day. They'd use the community toilet. They'd take the electricity home and the sun lantern through which they could charge their phone. They also had light with which they could read. There's all of these elements integrated. I think it's very difficult for any of us to sit here and say which human need, access to information, the ability to express yourself, which a smartphone enables, is that more or less important than electricity? Actually, they're coupled. And I think it's very difficult to, for us to say, oh, you're right, electricity first, or you're wrong, let's get to this health element or this learning element. So I think there are a couple systems, and sometimes it's surprising to see how pieces start to fit together.
All right, I think we have just one last question.
Thanks. My name is Nikhil Pawa. I run a site called Media Nama, which looks at internet issues. I wanted to get a sense of the house from the perspective of net neutrality and where they think India's headed, because we can talk about all the services that we want to provide on the internet, But if there's going to be balkanization of the internet or selection of services, and currently there's a consultation process that's about to begin in India for looking at revenue share arrangements and deals between internet services and mobile operators, that has a restrictive impact on access to services, because those who can't afford to pay telecom operators effectively can't afford to provide the service to consumers to quite an extent. So I just wanted to get a sense where we're headed in terms of net neutrality. What do you think? And sensitivity.
It's a tough question. I really don't think I'm equipped to be able to answer that. I know from a both my personal and from a company perspective, we believe in net neutrality. I think the way it's happening here in India, it is a bit of a challenge. But and it's completely different from what's happened in other parts of the world, where the services and the application service providers were able to get and provide on a neutral basis. Out here, the power is with the operators. The guy who has the pipe can dictate what goes through that pipe. And I think that's where the government and the regulatory authorities will have to play a bigger role.
A quick comment, not on net neutrality. That's a two-day discussion between us, because you know we have. It's a very, very complex issue. But I just want to talk about the point that was made about rural and how they'll get in. I just want to leave this number for the distinguished guests here. The mobile telephony, which is the cheaper, easier part to get out, we had for the first, well, it's been about 18 years. First 2 years, we had 2 million subscribers. In the next 6 years, we got 200 million subscribers. In the last 6 years, we've got 400 million subscribers additional, total of about 657, depending on what the numbers are. So the moment you put mobility and wireless to anything, the growth is usually phenomenal and exceeds most expectations that you would have. That's just a trend across the world. And so rural will, you know, eventually, to that point, it just, they will find technologies to fund that part. To the points that you made about pricing, I just want to say that telecom sector is perhaps the only sector in India where every single cost incurred by operators is filed almost on a monthly basis with the TRAI, who regulates the tariffs, and then decides not to regulate it for the past few years because the cost being offered is actually comparable. The reason why the prices are high, and not because there is a large margin, there is a margin of course, is because the input costs are really high, and that requires structural reforms. Thank you.
I think with that we should end the session. Thank you everyone for being here, and everyone joined. This was initially meant to be a free-form problem-solving discussion, became a panel, and then again a free-form problem-solving discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.